Okay. First of all, I want to thank the organizer for the invitations. So thanks all Arvin, Abhishek, Juan, Frank, Christopher, Manjunath, Tony, Sanjib, and Hugo. And I want to apologize because I will not speak of large deviation. I will speak of entropy. And I must tell you, nothing in my talk will be good as this joke if you speak French. So you can see. Okay. So, I want also a little to apologize for my English, but this is every time I apologize, and I think my level improves slowly. So today I will speak of a work that I did when I was in Vancouver last year with Momchilo Gavrilov, which is a PhD student of John Bischoffer, which is an experimentalist in SFU, Simon Fraser University. This work will appear this Tuesday in PNAS. So this work concerns the big subject is the second law. And you know that second law is very, very, very general things. It's maybe at the roots of all. For example, Albert Einstein tells the second law of thermodynamics is the only physical theory which I am convinced that it will never be overthrown. But also, the second principle can tell what you want that it tell. And by example, you have this POP 12, which tells that second thermodynamic law provides a demonstrative testimony to the existence of a higher being. Versus, well, this is a joke, but it was in The Onion, parody 2000, which was Catholic, which was not happy with the evolution of the entropy in front of Kansas Capitol. Because really, it's true that with second law, you can have the interpretation that you want. It's so general. And so what will be the main conceptual question of this talk? It is, what is the physical content of the Gibbs anentropy? In peculiar, outside equilibrium. And this is not a tautological question. By example, Joel Leibovitz, in a private note, very recent, tell, I have been worrying about this since I was a graduate student and still do not have a good answer. The same things, a little more odd, Jean Bricmont in Science of Chaos or Chaos in Science. But why should you use this Gibbs entropy out of equilibrium? In equilibrium, it's agree with Boltzmann and everything is fine. But out of equilibrium, we don't know. Or again, during the referee of this previous article, my article in PNAS, the referee one tells the physical meaning of the Shannon entropy away from equilibrium has been well established. Implicitly, you want to tell since long time. And the referee three tells, but I am concerned that the generality, which was that the Gibbs Shannon entropy is physical, of the result is overstated. So, you see, there was a conflict. And this conflict, I think, transposed in for a lot of people, there is a dichotomy from some people which think that this is a tautological question, and some people which think that it's not a tautological question. Gibbs Shannon has a sense just in equilibrium, has a physical sense, right? Just in equilibrium. And the main message of my talk will be the Gibbs Shannon entropy is physically consistent, still outside equilibrium. This is a conceptual message, and the clear message it is if you forget these conceptual things, we have a direct experimental measure of the entropy of 1 bit, so which is this p log dot p minus 1 p log 1 minus p, which is here. And this apparently is very good because here there is no fitting parameter. This is just experimental results that we have here. Okay, and in a sense, this is good because when people speak of entropy of a glass, I understand what it was. But when people speak of entropy of a bit, for me it was a little more questionable if this was a physics or not, 1 bit. Okay. So what is Gibbs anentropy? First, I want to tell that I will restrict to classical definitions, just classical physics today. So the definition is the integral of, you have an object which is associated with density rho, which is the minus integral of rho log rho, that I will note. Bra rho, ket log de rho. This is proportional to the amount of information needed to describe the random variable. By example, for the Bernoulli random variable, then you find this entropy of a bit, which depends of p. And if you begin with this, you can define a lot of other quantities which are related. By example, Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy, conditional entropy, mutual entropy. You have a lot of objects which come from this Gibbs Shannon. And who introduced this? First, I think it is Gibbs in his books in 1902, which don't call this explicit entropy, but there was a calculation. In the quantum case, where the bracket is a trace and rho is a matrix density, it is von Neumann in 1927. And really, the person which states the definition in the classical case is Claude Shannon in 1948, and it's von Neumann which advised Claude Shannon to call this notion entropy. Here, minus integral de rho log rho. Yeah. You don't like this cross things between the bracket? Yeah, not the bracket as this. It's good? No? It's a nothing except more little formula. Okay. First thing in the common agreement. The Gibbs Shannon at the equilibrium is good. It is the thermodynamical entropy. This is by example, Jean Bricmont. In equilibrium, it agrees with Boltzmann and everything is fine. So what is equilibrium for physicists? It is to take this Gibbs, where I call this the factor which permits to renormalize the equilibrium free energy. I put a one here because there will have four notions of equilibrium free energy in this talk. So this is the first notion, which is the equilibrium free energy, defined just as a log of the partition function. And then, if I look the Gibbs entropy to this GH, by definition is minus bracket GH log de GH, but log de GH is beta H minus beta F. And then we arrive to beta bracket GHH, which is the energy, minus this is constant. GH bracket with 1 is 1, because GH is normalizable. And then we arrive to beta F equilibrium. And this, you recognize, or you define the entropy if you begin with free energy in equilibrium, in thermodynamical. So this is good. The Gibbs Shannon entropy associated to this density has a good form for thermodynamical entropy. So here, no problem. Is there a question? Okay, where's the problem appear? Mainly, the problem will appear that this S de rho t is constant for a closed system which evolves with Hamiltonian evolution. So, by example, this pre-Jogin tells, according to the mechanical view of the world, you want to tell to the Hamiltonian view, I think, the entropy of the universe is today identical to what it was at the origin of the time. So, I will look at the time evolution of the Gibbs entropy. For the moment, I will take a very general evolution with master equation, first order in time, that I will note a generator adjoint which acts on rho t. And then, if I derivate, once again, the Gibbs Shannon, there will have two terms, rho t dot log de rho t, and rho t dot against 1. Rho t dot against 1 is 0, because rho t is normalizable. It stays with rho t dot against log de rho t. Rho t dot is Lt dagger rho t, and Lt adjoint can go in other place of the scalar product and be arrive here. And here, the first problem appears. This has no reason to be positive in general. No reason. So you will see in two slides, how you do, it's not that the second principle is wrong, it is also that this is not interesting, it is just that you must add something in general so that it becomes positive. But okay, for the moment, I want to concentrate on the second problem, which is what happens if I have a deterministic system, means just a first order equation, which can be a Hamiltonian equation, means that x can be q and p in the phase space. So the operator which was here is the Liouville operator, which is a first order differential operator. And then this formula becomes f grad log de rho t. Grad log de rho t is grad de rho t sur on rho t, which simplify here. So it means that in the bracket of f with grad de rho, which means by interaction by part, that it is div de f against rho. And then, if you have a divergence left drift, yeah, then the Gibbs entropy is constant. You can avoid this. But what happens in particular, is it for the Hamiltonian deterministic dynamics? Q dot equal P, p dot égale minus grad de V, you have this divergence which is zero. And then you have the Gibson entropy which is constant. And the problem arrives when you want to express the Clausius second law, which is Clausius formulation of the second law, which is the entropy of the universe tend to a maximum. Okay? But then, if the system universe is Hamiltonian, you have a problem. Because this little calculus tells you that this is not possible. This is constant if you are Hamiltonian. So, we can discuss this story that the system is Hamiltonian, but if you don't discuss this, that the universe is a closed system at the end, if you take all in the system, you have a problem, and then this Gibson entropy don't do the jobs for Hamiltonian closed systems. This is the main argument that people, by example, Sheldon Goldstein and Joel Lebowitz, tell it is therefore inappropriate, we believe, to use Gibsonon or quantity like it in derivation of the second law. Okay. So what was the solution? This is very old. I think it was understood 1930, long time before 2003. And what was the solution which was proposed? The first solution, it is to change the entropy, to tell no, this Gibsonon is not a good object. There is another object, which is called the Boltzmann entropy, which comes from Boltzmann, and which will increase for closed systems. And this is the idea promoted by Joel Lebowitz mainly, and collaborator, by example, this Physics Today, 1993. And the second idea, or escape way, is coarse grain. If you coarse grain the solution, no problem. And by example, this Gibbs understood this in very, very long time ago, Ehrenfest also, that if you coarse grain, okay, at the end you can have an increasing of the entropy. I will not enter into details, but it's not very the only things to really understand is when you lose information, you increase. Your Gibson entropy increase. Is there a question? Here is space coarse graining. So it is just that you have a row at the beginning, and you tell, okay, now I give you a partition of the phase space in domain, and I give you a density, which is here, which is constant in each domain. And the constant is the average of the domain. Here you change the density. And this is one way to do coarse graining. I don't know. Here it's maybe you are true, and this is more involved explanation. My explanation was very simple. Just I look the density, the coarse grain density, and the entropy associated to the coarse grain density is bigger than the entropy associated to the complete density, the fine grain density, and just this. No. No. Yes. Because, by example, Lebowitz. By example, Joel Lebowitz tells that this is very cheap. One problem that you have, okay, at the end, I can prove this very quickly, means that the Gibson entropy associated to the coarse grinding density, which evolved from rho 0 to t, is bigger to rho 0. But you can't prove that this is increasing functions. I can't prove that with S here, rho S, rho 0, coarse grinding. You must coarse grain at S, evaluate, coarse grain at T, and then you have the things. If you don't coarse grain at each time, you don't increase. Moreover, this will tell you that the second law is just a concept of an ability of this and that thing. And some people, as Lebowitz, don't like. They tell second principle is also for one, not for density. And moreover, it doesn't depend if I look or if I don't look. Yeah. This exactly. This is the arguments of people after the PRL, the Physics Today. There was a lot of discussions. This Caves and Fuchs of quantum mechanics told exactly this. Yeah, it's can be seen. But okay. Moreover, for Boltzmann entropy, you can't prove nothing, because the proof asks you to prove that there is at the macroscopic level a closed equation. So it's very complicated things to begin with a microscopic. It's a problem of ASEP, finally. You can do for a very toy model that at the end you have a microscopic equation for the density. But okay, it's very complicated in general. Okay. And now I want pass for the second, for the open systems. I told you, for the open in general, my Gibbs entropy was not increasing. So what I must to add, I must to add something which concerns what happens in the buff, because the open system, it's a system and a buff. And this was a long time ago. So now I must introduce three different entropy. One which is the total entropy productions, one which is the entropy, and one which is the variation of the system entropy. So we have three objects, and the second principle, it is that one of these objects, the total entropy production, is positive. But then, what is the mathematical expression for this free entropy? This is not so clear for the moment, and as there is this equality, we need two rules for fixing these three quantities. So the first rule is what I call hypothesis H1, it is this system entropy is a Gibsonon. Aldous, the initial and final entropy, are not Gibbs in general. So this is a totally hypothesis. And the question it is it a physical or just mathematical tricks? And if physical, can we use this for a direct measure of S bit of P? By example, in this talk, Joel, in the talk of the same talk that I speak before, Joel tells the question therefore naturally arises of why this should be true for small systems in contact with thermal reservoir, when, as argued above, this is not the case for isolated systems. This is the idea that in French, quand tu peux le plus, tu peux le moins. So, normally, if it is true for system in contact with a reservoir, when I cut the contact, it must stay true for isolated system, and it is not the case. So, it is not so evident hypothesis. Okay, so this was how I fix S. So, I don't know if for you if it's evident that it's... It just before isolated system, you have no this SB. So you come back to the Hamiltonian case, where there was the problem. Okay, the second hypothesis is what is this object? If I tell you, if I have two rules, I fix the three objects. So first rule, hypothesis H1. Second rule, hypothesis H2. And it appears that a good way to fix this positive object, it is as a relative entropy in a path space, where this P of X is the probability of the path X, and this PB of X backward is the probability for another process, a backward process, of the backward path. If I do this, I have a good property that of positivity is evident, of additivity in T, for a lot of Markov process. And then, this is the relative entropy. You are true that you speak of the fluctuating quantity definition, which is better. But in this talk, I don't need to have the fluctuating definitions. I need just to have the average. So for me, there is no fluctuating quantity in this talk. But you are true that fluctuation ration can be understood exactly with the definition that this object, but fluctuating, it is this ratio. Exactly. But when you average, it becomes relative entropy. Okay, and then, with Hugo, in these books, we prove that you can, this is a little mathematical object, huh? It's a very big space, this traditional space. You can, in general, come back to one point measure. By example, for a time homogeneous process, if I have this degree of freedom, I choose the backward process. And if I choose the backward process, which is a double transform of the adjoint of the generator, so double H of something, it is H minus 1 LH, which acts on the right, minus H minus 1 L H, which act as a multiplication. And then we can prove that this object, the reproduction, is this difference of relative entropy in one point space. I can generalize this. If no, I have a time homogeneous process, it don't exist the invariant density. So just the same things where what plays the role of the invariant density, which be the time explicit density, just with the different initial conditions, zero prime. Sorry?
For diffusive process.
No. For a Langevin equation, just. For gradient drift. For gradient drift, yeah. Just. Yeah, you tell me diffusive. Oh yeah, of course, because this is not the good inversion. For general diffusion process, if you want to find Lebovitz spawn, you must to take LB, LBT, equal L de T minus T. For diffusion process general. And this is the case that corresponds to this. Okay, here it was homogeneous, so this corresponds to this. Just for Langevin equation, gradient drift. If not, it's other inversion. No, so this don't correspond to the Lebovitz spawn things, except for gradient drift. Okay, so here you arrive to the same, the difference of the entropy of the final density plus the relative entropy of initial density. And what I want to tell is that the right-hand side and the left-hand side is positive by definitions. And so you have the positive of the right-hand side, and this is the classical version of the second principle for Markovian process, which exists long time before fluctuation relations, the positivity of this, or the positivity of this, and which was, by example, proved by Lebovitz-Bergmann in 1957, Risken, paragraph 6.1 for diffusion process, or Gardiner, paragraph 3.7.3 for mixed process. Okay, and now for the general things, for the general process non-homogeneous, in general, this inversion is a very complicated things to do experimentally. So I will do another inversion here, which is with P also the double transform, but this time P is a zero eigenvalue of the adjoint of the generator, what I call accompanying density. And then, if you do the same game, you transform this as this, which is finally the Herbert spawn definition of entropy productions that I call XS. So Herbert spawn did for quantum things, but it you can do also for classical things. So, in a sense, this object permits to refine what you know very well since long time, so how you formulate the second principle for Markovian process. Okay, but I told this hypothesis H1 and H2 are just for fix what are the objects. But the principle can be written without know what are the analytical expressions for the object. And by example, now if I restrict to the case with one equilibrium BAF beta, then of inverse temperature beta, then the heat that the bath receive is temperature time SB, and then the second law, which was before, I can just plug SB to beta Q and become this, beta Q plus delta S bigger than zero. This is true all the time. And if you break this, it means that you don't put the good things in what you are in the systems. By example, people recently claim that this is broken when you extract information of a system, but you can resist just, no, it's not broken. It is just that in the S, you must to tell the system and you, experimentalists, which extract information. So now if I use the first law for access to the work, I can put Q is work minus delta W E and arrive to this formulation of the second work with the work done, with the second law with the work done, which is delta. The work is bigger than delta E minus beta minus 1 delta S. And now I define this E minus temperature S as a non-equilibrium free energy. And this is the second non-free energy which appears in my talk. Once again, this is totally general. This don't depend of H1, what I take for the entropy system, and of H2, what I take the expression for the entropy productions. But these two hypotheses gives you the analytic form of SB, then of Q, then of W. And you can ask, as H1 and H2 has very mathematical oriented hypothesis, we can wonder if this gives a physical form for the work W. So I can go for this in the context where the experiment will be down, which is the overdamped Langevin equations. So I have this gradient drift diffusion process. Then the average energy is just bracket of rho with H. And then the way where I will define the entropy productions, I must tell you what is the backward. I will take the backward the more naive, which is just I read the Hamiltonian in the backward sense. So this here don't correspond to this way to do inversions, but this way to do inversion. You can prove that for Langevin equation, so you will find this expression. If you can prove that this double transform with respect to P is exactly the fact that you change the time of the way where you read the Hamiltonian. And then you have the expression just before for XS. Then from S, PE XS, and S of the system you access to SBAF. Then from SBAF, you access to the heat. From the heat, you access to the work. And you prove that the work, it is this physical work that you wait, the integral of delta THT. OK, so this you are happy. But now you will reverse the perspective. Reciprocally, if we fix the previous form of the work, if you tell, no, no, I have no free form of entropy. What is physical is my work. So if you fix the previous form of the work, H1 and H2 are no longer independent. And we will do this as a physicist. We will now consider this logic. We fix the physical work. Now H1 and H2 become dependent. And then you need just one hypothesis. One rules will fix, one rules plus the work will fix the three objects, the three entropy. So for theoreticians which consider that H1, this identity between the entropy and the Gibbs entropy is a tautological, then in fact, you can tell that you prefer to check H2, which is this form of entropy production as a relative entropy in the big space. Okay, and by example, fluctuation relations, which come directly, as Kiron told before, from a fluctuating version of H2. In a sense, check this H2 hypothesis when you check the fluctuation relation experimentally. But okay, check a very special case, because if you have A, which imply B, which imply C, which imply D, and you check experimentally D, this don't prove A. So it is okay here. When you check experimentally fluctuation relations, you are far from checking totally this hypothesis H2. Okay, I told you this second principle is totally general, or initial final density as you want. And now I will restrict my theory for a peculiar case of initial and final initial density. No equilibrium, but peculiar case. So I come back to a cause winning with respect to state space partitions. So I have my space, state space gamma. I have partitions in subdomain, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3. And then a density rho, first, give a population, which is how much people are in one domain, in the domain I. And a conditional distribution, which is, if I know that I am in the domain gamma I, what is my density? And then the two give the total low probability that rho can be reconstructed if you know the populations and the conditional density. And so what will be the class of initial and final density, which will be interesting? It will be the local equilibrium state. So it's no equilibrium, but conditionally, if you are in a domain, it will be equilibrium. So I will introduce this conditional Gibbs density and conditional free energy. So it's the third notion of free energy that you saw, which has the same form that before for the Gibbs density, except that now you are restricted to one domain. Outside this domain, it is zero everywhere. And the conditional free energy, when you do the integration, is just on the domain gamma I. So this, by example, in this nature physics paper, thermic of affirmation, they define this object and the gamma I as possible informational states, kind of coarse-grained state where you can store information. Okay, and what is the local equilibrium state for me? Associated to any discrete probability Q, it is Q is free, but conditioning to be in gamma I, you are in equilibrium. So it's linear combination with Q to this conditional Gibbs density. So the population are free. It's not the good global population, but when you are in a domain, you are in Gibbs locally. So it's given here. And now, one little remark is that if I have an application which goes from a domain to other with unit Jacobian and with invariant Hamiltonian, then directly, with this formula, by change of variable, you prove that this conditional free energy is the same for the domain E and for the domain G. This is just change of variable in the definitions of the conditional free energy. Okay, and armed with all these notions, I can express my continuous Gibbsian entropy as a sum of four terms, this discrete associated to the populations, the energy, this FP, which is the average free energy, which is the four notions, which is the sum of all the domains of the populations times the conditional free energy, minus the last term, which tells you how much I am far from this local equilibrium. This is the relative entropy. And you can also write this formula with no equilibrium free energy, which no. Yeah, the P are special class of Q, which are associated to rho. Q was general, and P was the Q associated to the rho. And so, if you write this instead to S2 E minus beta minus beta minus 1 S, then the non-equilibrium free energy will be the sum of three things, this F2P, this average free energy, a discrete thing, and the distance from local equilibrium. And this formula generalizes a very well famous between non-equilibrium free energy, equilibrium free energy these times, and entropic deficiency, which is here. This formula was famous. This was not famous, but you pass from here to here just by telling that you have just one domain, by example. If you have one domain, just this local equilibrium devient the global equilibrium. This disappears because P equals 1, and this F to P becomes F equilibrium of H. Okay, so this is a generalization of this in the case where you have many domains. Okay, but now that I have this non-equilibrium free energy, I can reformulate my second law, just because here at the right of the second law, I was the difference of non-equilibrium free energy. Now appears three terms, which are the three terms just before. And now, with respect to a discrete second law, which is in blue, I have two corrective terms, one which is delta F to P, here, and one which is this distance to local equilibrium. Delta F to P, it is called asymmetric term. It was introduced by Shizum mainly, and exactly on this form by Takahiro Segawa in 2009. And why we call asymmetric term? Because if we have this symmetry that I told you before, where the F is then constant, the conditional free energy is constant in all the domain, then if I am constant, this becomes just the constant times on the peak, which is one. So F to P is just one of the value. And then delta F to P is just one of this value, but associated to HT, minus one of this value associated to H0. So if I am cyclic, it is zero. So it is for this that it is called asymmetric term. And finally, if I now do disappear this term by telling just that I begin and finish in local equilibrium, then this disappears, and I arrive to this second principle with just one correction term with respect to naive discrete second principle. And this was called by Sagawa Ueda, generalize or breakdown Landauer principle. For me, it is not a good idea to call this generalize or breakdown, because this means that you wait as the fundamental things, the discrete second law. And for me, it's not evident. Second law is at the continuum level, and nothing evident to write directly in an ad hoc way these things in blue. But in this field of Landauer principle, a lot of persons consider bit as a physical thing and this directly write the blue things as a fundamental equation. So for me, it's not a breakdown. It was just that the good second law was at the continuum level, and when you pass from the continuum to the discrete, sometimes you have corrections which can disappear if you have symmetric double well, by example. Okay, one advertisement is that this discrete second law that I prove here supposes H1. Since I arrive in this discrete case, for prove this, I suppose that S is Gibsonian for pass from continuum to discrete. If not, I can't do the cost grading. I don't know how to do if I have no formula for S. So, before to pass to the experiment, I will do partial conclusions. In our Eraser experiment, we measure at long intermediate time. So, intermediate because we don't want to finish in the true Gibbs. We don't want to finish in the true equilibrium. But we want to finish in this local equilibrium, which will arrive in intermediate asymptotic regime. So we measure the reversible work for all value of a parameter P. You will see after what it will be, but it will be the population of the left wall sometimes. And this is totally independent of the H1 hypothesis, totally. This is totally experimental things. However, in these situations, the previous discrete second law become an equality, and then you can access theoretically to W H1 because you use H1 reversible. So you can compare the result for the value of P, and then we find a perfect agreement. So this proves our message that the Gibson entropy is physically consistent, still outside equilibrium, because the initial and final density are locally equilibrium, they are not global Gibbs. So you can ask the question, if this message was not already implied by the previous experiment on Landauer erasure. Because when Landauer tell find log de 2, the heat is minored by log de 2, then log de 2 comes from S de P. So in a sense, it was true that Landauer tell this message in a sense, except that he tells this message in one point. He tells this message in P equal 1 half just. And so for have really something which is convincing, you must look at this for show that two functions are the same. If you look just in one point, it's very little. So here's the K experimental point was experimental, yeah, was that we have the control of this P. They have, experimentally, the total control of P, and then we can play the game to see, to vary the P. Okay, but logically, I want to tell that we don't prove that H1 is true. Because what is the same. A implique B. If you experimentally check B, you can't conclude that A was right. And so the strict logic can't prevent some logical loophole. By example, H1 could be right only for local equilibrium states, for this little class of non-equilibrium states, and not for more general non-equilibrium states. Or worst, H1 could be wrong for all states in the beginning, but for a strange reason, right at the discrete level. Or other way, H1 and the discrete second law could be wrong in general, but become right just in this intermediate time limit. And you can play all the rules to find loophole strong, weaker and weaker. And by example, this fact that H1 is right, H1 was the identity between the Shannon entropy and the system entropy, is true just in this peculiar case of our experiment, but not in a general case, is a view sustained by Joel Leibovitz, by example. It's not my view, but Joel Leibovitz thinks that our experiment proves that the Gibbs Shannon is a Gibbs entropy for weakly non-equilibrium things. It's for this that there is a term weakly in my title of the article. Finally, there is a last possibility for preventing this problem of logic, which is to consider in ad hoc way that this is true at the discrete level, with S, which is general. See, if you consider this as a, if you consider the results that you obtain at the discrete level, as we obtain from the continuum level, but if you consider this as a fundamental thing, no problem. Then if it's fundamental, we check rigorously that this becomes the Gibbs Shannon with the experiment. And at the end, if you forget all this story of fondement, and you tell, okay, I accept H1, I accept that the entropy is the Gibson entropy, then our experiment is the experimental measure of this, which was maybe the first. So, what was the experiment? It is a system colloidal particle, micron silica bead of 1.5 micrometer of diameter, the feedback trap, which do four steps, image particle, she estimate positions, we calculate the force, and we apply voltage for do the force that we want for mimic the potentials, mimics the effective one-dimensional overdamped Langevin equation in a time-dependent double well potential. Symmetric double well potential we'll choose here. So, the initial and final state will be every time this local equilibrium in an even double well potential. Then if it's even and cyclic, this asymmetry disappears because we have this symmetry. And then the protocol more or less will be a radio experiment, means at the beginning I am somewhere in the double well, I lower the barrier, no, I am everywhere. I push on the right by tilting. When I am sure that my particle is on the right, I uppering the barrier. No, you know she's trapped in the right, and now I can untilting without risk for come back to the beginning. So it will be in the theory of before, of course, running, just with two domains, the left well and the right well. So you have just one population, which will be the left population, the right population, which will be just one minus P. And then we do two experiments. The first is a complete erasure of a fraction of bit. Then the initial state is a local equilibrium with a population P0, which will be the free parameter. So P0 is not 1/2. The final state is a local equilibrium with total erasure, all in the right. Then delta S is 0 minus SB to P0. And then the discrete second law, it is this. The correction disappears because I begin and finish in local equilibrium and because I am symmetric. And that in the intermediate time where I am reversibility, I find this equality. That I can check. So I can check what is W reversible, and this will give me what is this S bit de P0. I do this game, and I find exactly this, or more precisely, they find just the black, because there is one problem, experimental limitation, which is that we have a little, very little range of P0, close to the maximum, because it is the first step. I want to have this reversibility in this intermediate time regime. So I can't do the lowering too strong. I must be very clever for doing this lowering first step. And I must be clever by transforming this local equilibrium with this population to a true equilibrium with respect to the same population. I do this, I must finish. I do this by just stretching the potential, finally. I transform my potential such that which was non-equilibrium populations become equilibrium populations. But this is very long things, which restrict the limitation. And then this gives me just the black things. So we do a second experiment, which are the partial erasure of the symmetric bit. This is the contrary. So I begin with the symmetric 1/2, 1/2, but this time I will stop until to have the total erasure. And here there is another problem that knows the parameter is pt, and I have no, it's complicated at large time to control pt, p infini experimentally. It's very controlled because it's complicated to control this experimentally. So here there is theoretical development, which are related to something which is called conditional fluctuation relation, which is kind of fluctuation relations, but conditionally of where I will go and where I begin. And with this, we can prove a kind of refinite second principle in kind of limit. And with refinite second principle, we can check exactly the white things. So, conclusions. Thank you for your attention. Sorry if at the end I was too blurry. And I hope to contradict this French proverb for the end of my talk.
I'm trying to understand again the reasoning. Okay. So I can define all these entropic quantities for Markov processes. If I want this to match with the law of thermodynamics, then that will fix the definition of the work and
there is two things. The second principle, the inequality, you can write without doing the hypothesis.
No, but if I want to connect the
exactly, if you want to have a physical work, then you must fix what do you call the entropy system, what do you call the entropy production of the universe.
But if I start with Markov processes, I define all these quantities, then I want to relate to physics, this will fix the way I define the work.
Exactly.
What you're saying is that I take the work as being defined that.
This is physicists who do this.
Then I go the other way around.
And then I have just one degree of freedom, which is free. Or I choose S, or I choose SB, or I choose entropy production. I have just one degree of freedom. If I fix the work, just one quantity is free now.
So what I'm saying is, I'm just generalizing what we know about Markov processes to everything. We know that this connection is actually consistent for Markov processes. No?
But because my experiment will calculate the work with this formula.
Yeah, exactly.
By following each particle and by integrating delta T H T. Repeat your question. If I have a hypothesis that I can... Experimentally? Yes. How do you know this? By example, they know because they find the equality. If not, there is a correction. There is a correction.
If you do the dynamics not too carefully, starting the partial Gibbs state.
But the weight, but the weight, the experiment is in intermediate time limit. They wait sufficiently long time. They wait sufficiently long time that you arrive in this local equilibrium, but not in global equilibrium. But you are true, you are never exactly inside. So there is a range, all the difficulties, there is a range of time. Experimentally, they tell infinite. They claim that to arrive to the Gibbs, you need 2 weeks. And that very quickly, you arrive to the local equilibrium. But you are true. But the fact that they find an inequality at the end, here, means that this term disappears. In a sense. But you are true. Probably, you are right, yeah. Okay, and also, with respect to your work, by example, when I tell this, you know, your work proves that at finite time, for half the reversibility, you must do things very different than this. This is totally experimental way to do this erasure. But what you prove it is that you must to shift this until the end, and suddenly, at finite time, push the barrier, push, and in infinite time at the end, go down the barrier. This has nothing to do with this. But because when you take your process and you do the infinite time, you have to something which is very, very singular. So I agree, this is not a good way to obtain the reversibility at infinite time, but it is apparently the problem disappears in this intermediate time regime. Thanks.